And welcome once again to EWTN's Bookmark. I am Doug Keck, your host. Our special guest author is Benjamin Wiker, who along with Scott Hahn wrote the book The Decline and Fall of Sacred Scripture, How the Bible Became a Secular Book, published by Emmaus Road Publishing, available naturally through the EWTN Religious Catalog, EWTNRC.com, all things Catholic. It's great to see you, Benjamin Wiker.
And thanks for having me, sir.
Now, a lot of people know you from being on the network multiple times. You've been on with Father Mitch, of course, and a wonderful series, Saints and Scoundrels. Now, I know Scott's the saint, so are you the scoundrel?
Well, that didn't take long. Yeah, I mean, that's it. I don't have anything else to say after that.
There you go. So when we, the series, let's talk a little bit about that, because sure. It's a wonderful series. I love it. And the idea of saints and scoundrels. Why is it important for us to understand both sides of that? And how does that dovetail into our understanding even of a book like this today?
Well, what we try to do in Saints versus Scoundrels is have the both sides speak so you see that there's something called profound evil. Evil isn't silly. The demons aren't, you know, intellectually challenged. They're far more brilliant than human beings. And a lot of the scoundrels are too, but the saints themselves, having truth on their side, are able to work through the errors and bring about what people should be understanding. So in the Saints versus Scoundrels series, we want people to understand these big errors that have caused so many problems. And truly understand them in a way that they can be able to relate them in a public account. So in other words, when you're talking to somebody, yeah, I understand what Karl Marx said, or I understand what Machiavelli said, and I understand what the response to them is. So we always try to have that matchup, in a real good matchup. It's not like, oh, here's a scoundrel and we're going to have the saint just pummel him to death. It's no, let's hear what this person has to say and what really might be at the bottom of it and what the faith has to answer that.
Right. And again, to get past sometimes their little bite-sized talking points to maybe some of the deeper thought that they had that people may not be aware of and how some of that could be incredibly dark.
Exactly. But also profoundly influencing. And we really can't understand say the sexual revolution until we understand somebody like Jean-Jacques Rousseau,
right?
Because he's at the foundation of it. So we, you know, we go through the people that are most influential. Of course, we did Margaret Sanger, mm-hmm. As well. We did Nietzsche, the profound philosopher. But we, you know, what was the opposite of that? It was a saint who had studied philosophy, Edith Stein. So. Mm-hmm. So they're real matchups. You know, it's not a straw man or woman thing.
Right.
As you heard, one of the villains, who is a profoundly evil person, that is, he's profound and evil, is Machiavelli.
Mm-hmm.
So we had him opposite St. Francis, but he's also makes his way into the decline and fall of sacred scripture.
Right. Well, let's talk about that. We talk about in today's world the Great Reset. You talk about the Great Divide. And then you have a quote in the very beginning. It says, Scripture died a quiet death in Western Christendom sometime in the 16th century. How did you decide on that date?
Well, what we mean by that is that Scripture among the elite began to be seen as a myth, that is, as a book of mythology. It wasn't something that should define your life and was telling you about reality. And so you have the beginning of what will end in, develop into modern scriptural scholarship, where the Bible itself is not treated as a sacred scripture, but as a kind of book of mythology that you study in a detached way.
Mm-hmm.
The reason that the date is so important is it's way before modern science. In fact, we go back to the 1300s with Marsilius of Padua and show that these assumptions that there can't be any miracles, Jesus couldn't have been divine, which are assumptions of modern scriptural scholarship, what you'll get today in a graduate school, except in a few places,
mm-hmm.
are found all the way back prior to modern science and have their roots not in an understanding of reality, but in a false philosophy. So that's why we go way back. We want to show the roots of this are much different than we might think.
I think what's also interesting is to realize so much of these things are not really theological in the sense of how they're looked at. Many of them are practical and political, aren't they?
Yeah, in fact, that's the foundation, as we show in detail, of the whole secularizing of the Bible itself. So you go into a scriptural scholarship seminar now at almost any graduate school, and you'll be taught that the Bible was mythological, and you don't take anything seriously. You're just trying to find out what was, you know, behind it, what really happened. And we show that that assumption is, as we say, goes all the way back into the 1300s, but actually goes back into pagan philosophy. Mm-hmm. And the assumption is there's no greater reality than our physical bodily reality. Mm-hmm. And so there's no real power higher than political power. And in the ancient pagan world, and this is revived in the modern world, the notion that religion isn't true, but it's useful in politics for controlling the masses, is what's actually at the foundation of the origin of modern historical critical scholarship. Of course, you have to find your way back through the generations to find the origin of the idea and how it developed, but that's really what's essential. And we call it politicizing the Bible, because you're not really taking what it tells you as revealed truth. You're assuming there's no truth higher than material truth, and there's no God, there's no afterlife, there's no soul. And so if we're going to have religion, it's going to be something useful for the rulers to control the unwashed masses.
Right, which was what Marx said, basically. That was his whole point, right, about religion.
Yes, absolutely. And Marx, you know, Marxism has been all the rage in academics in general for over 100 years. He didn't go away when the Soviet Union fell. He seems to have gotten more powers, actually. But it also defined the approach that many scriptural scholars took to the Old Testament, especially, but also the New. You know, Jesus, okay, we all know Jesus didn't rise from the dead. We all know he wasn't God, because there is no God. But he's really a kind of a good Marxist socialist a leader that we can emulate it and use for political purposes, as long as we take out all the miracle stuff and the divine stuff. So you find it at the foundation of politicizing scripture by Marxism. And that, I wish I could tell you that trend was over, but it's not at all.
Well, it's interesting how once socialism fails practically, it can go back into academia where it can just be theory. And theory is a wonderful thing, right?
Well, it's been there for so long, and they you study the history of Marxism, and this is both in scriptural scholarship and outside of it. What they did is they rebranded it, and said, well, it's not really exactly about the capitalists versus the proletariat. It's about any oppressor versus the oppressed. So it's about white versus black, or it's about the patriarchy versus the matriarchy. And this finds itself, lo and behold, what a shock, in scriptural scholarship,
right?
Where this or that author will say, well, the problem with the Bible is it's patriarchal,
right?
It's the oppressor, and we need to liberate the Bible from those constraints. And of course, it's not divinely revealed anyway,
right?
So we're just using it as a way for us to advance, in one sense, Marxism, in another sense, feminism. Mm-hmm. And we go over some of that in the beginning of Decline and Fall of Sacred Scripture, because that's really what's going on in so many of the religious studies departments and the biblical studies departments. And it's been that way for well over 100 years. And it defines how the intellectual class, we might call them, views not only the Bible, but also people who actually believe that it might be true.
Right.
They haven't heard the news yet, and we can feel sorry for them, but we can't let them get in the way of our project.
Absolutely. It's really, and you see it spinning in the direction it is now in this kind of postmodernism kind of thing with Foucault and those kind of people like that, where you get that everything's about oppress and oppressor, right?
Yeah. Right. And this goes all the way back. Again, you say, whoa, that's so modern. That's so cutting edge. No, that's so 1300s. Because the whole point for Marsilius way back then was to reformulate our understanding of the Bible so that it's really about how to use it politically for those who are in power over those who are not in power. So as a political instrument, then, if that's all the truth there is in it, it can be manipulated by anyone in political power. And that is part of the history of modern scriptural scholarship, is that you have, you know, figure after figure from, you know, you have Machiavelli, you have Hobbes, you have Locke, and later somebody like Marx. But these other figures that I just mentioned prior to Marx were all actually part of the foundation of modern scriptural scholarship, even though, if you really understand them, they're known atheists who believe that religion is simply something to be manipulated. And they turn that manipulation into an actual method. And that method's called the historical critical method.
Right. Well, what let's talk about that, because you make a differentiation between some terms that are similar, right?
Yeah, the difficulty is the technical vocabulary can sometimes mislead you. So, for example, somebody will say to me, well, do you mean we shouldn't take into account historical sources? And you say, well, no, we should take into account historical sources. There's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with understanding the history, geography, and everything else about the, you know, the ancient Palestine area. Oh, that's wonderful. But to say that there is no revelation, there are no miracles, and everything has to be reduced to history and comes from history is another story. And should we not be critical? Should we be uncritical? No, what we should do is give up the notion that being critical means assuming that there is no God, that there's only a body, there's no soul, and there can't be any miracles. Mm-hmm. And so in a way, what you have is the terms have been, for better or worse, hijacked by the scholars. Mm-hmm. So that if I say, well, I want you to study history to my students, and both this book and the book that's related to Politicizing the Bible were just immense history lessons. History is wonderful. You need it to understand things. Being critical is wonderful, but you have to define what you really mean by those terms. And so that's one of the things we're trying to clarify for scriptural scholarship, because we're really trying to start a kind of revolution. We need to peel this back and be, and I'm using Pope Benedict's words, we need to be critical of historical criticism,
right,
of the notion that the Bible is merely a book of mythology. You know, all the people in the know that. Well, that's not true.
Right. You say our aim is to make readers aware of the connection between the historical criticism in biblical studies and the politicization of the biblical text, or more accurately, to make readers understand how the politicization of the Bible led to the creation of historical criticism and its various methods, a development that began, as we've noted, 7 centuries before. And you talk about Funk, and that's the Jesus seminar, and the let's vote on what we believe, which beat are you putting in, it's whether this really happened, did Jesus really say that, they get it down to, I think they might think he said one thing, possibly. I forget what the actual number they came up with was.
Oh, it's very small. If you see one of these books that they brought out, I think it was called The Five Gospels, the Jesus Seminar. And so in a kind of a sacrilegious, what they did is they said, hey, if we don't think Jesus said it, then it's in bold black print. If we think that he did say it, it's in red print. If we think that he didn't say it, but it's kind of helpful, it's in gray print. Mm-hmm. And if we think that he might have said something sort of like it, it's in pink print. Right. And as you pointed out, for them, their account of the New Testament is almost all in black. Mm-hmm. Everything Jesus says, especially anything that relates to his divinity, is in bold black, meaning he never could have said this. And I think in one gospel, the only thing that he could have said was that got red treatment was "Our Father."
Right. There you go.
Yeah.
You also alluded to it, the idea that they believe there was like this post-death enhancement of Jesus, right?
Yes. Yes. And that goes back to really, now this is should strike us as odd because scriptural scholars think they're on the cutting edge of the intellectual world, but these are very ancient ideas. The notion that there are no real miracles at all, and all religious claims that there are miracles are all because the guys in the know, the philosophers who were also political rulers, understood they had to use religion and had to make up these stories.
Right.
Okay, so they make up these stories to control other people, and that finds its way into modern historical critical scholarship in the way that they treat anything in there.
Right.
That there's some, you know, this has been a manipulated text. It doesn't really mean what it says. And our job as scholars is to get to the foundation of what really happened and what caused this. And you find all kinds of wacky stories, but there aren't really any new stories. The things that modern scriptural scholars will tell you, oh, this is cutting edge. Oh, Jesus really had children, or Jesus was an illegitimate child. Well, that's old hat. You know, that stuff's been around actually for several centuries, and the treatment of a text like that has been around since the pagan world. So basically what they're doing is saying they're denying the faith, and they're trying to come up with some kind of a story that they can tell about what really must have happened. I mean, we know we didn't rise from the dead, and so what do we think happened? Well, there's no control over it then, because they can make up anything.
Right.
And so that's what you find, and we note some of those scholars so that students, readers of the book who aren't familiar with historical critical scholarship can say, wow, that's really not good. That's really wacky. And then we go back and say, yeah, but these guys didn't make it up. They're really old hat, even though they think they're cutting edge.
Well, it's interesting because probably half of those things came out in the first century, let alone even just a few centuries ago, in the sense of what some of the criticism would have been of our Lord at the time. It's also interesting, the point you make, I thought, was the idea, in a sense, they look and say, well, we don't believe this stuff really happened, but look how they used it to be so successful with their religion. So there's nothing wrong with us now taking the same idea and using it for our purposes.
Yeah, in other words, they're saying, well, look, it couldn't have been true. So it really must have been that, Eusebius, working under Constantine, thought, hey, this is a great story. How can I use this to help buttress the emperor's power? And that becomes the source of the political control of the church by the emperor. And so the whole thing is contaminated by this, the whole notion of the church. All the divine stories were really ways for the Emperor Constantine and those who followed after him to control the unwashed and ignorant masses. And so you get this account by the modern scriptural scholars, and then they say, as you said, but really, this is what we're going to use. We're going to use it for Marxism. So,
right. You
know, all they're doing is substituting one political leader for the one they happen to like, or we're going to use it for,
right. And
a lot of it you get, what we call left secularism. We're going to use it for the latest thing. We're going to overturn all patriarchy. We're going to overturn all sexism. Right. We're going to overturn all racism. And that's the only legitimate use of the text, which is a political use.
Right. And for some, like a Machiavelli, he would say, well, religion's good. Let's go back to the pagans, because he liked their version of religion better. It fit his view of politics. You also talk about in the Jesus Seminar, Dominic Crossan, who said the real Jesus was an anti-establishment radical, is kind of what you said earlier, championing religious and economic egalitarian and striking out at hierarchical and patriarchal powers, much like those on the left side of cultural and political spectrum today. Exactly what you were just talking about, right?
Yeah, exactly. And it's almost comical, except that people buy their books, and they read them and go, oh, he's right.
And this is a little off topic, but aren't you always surprised how many people reject the miraculous aspects of Scripture, but believe in these fantasies that are just have no basis in fact or history?
Yeah, I mean, some of the times when you know you read what the historical critical scholar says, and I remember reading these, and I guess it was when I was in the latter part of graduate school, and I'm thinking, this explanation of what you think really happened rather than the miracle would be more miraculous than the thing you're trying to describe away.
Right.
It doesn't
even
make any sense.
Right, exactly.
You know, and you get to that point, you're thinking, this is ridiculous how far out of your way you have to go.
You talk about so many people, you talk about Hobbes, you talk about Locke, Erasmus, Machiavelli, but you also talk about William of Ockham, and you hear his name more and more today. Now, he had a razor. Was he a barber? Why is he known? What's this Ockham razor stuff?
This Ockham guy. Well, Ockham is a good example of some, and always run when you hear this, somebody who had good intentions, okay? And he saw that the papacy was not in good shape at that time. That's the time of the Babylonian captivity and, you know, the Avignon papacy, where things weren't good. Basically, the popes were rich and they were hostages to the French and under the French king. So Marsilius is on one side of the thing and William Ockham is on the other side, but they end up reinforcing each other and beginning the secularization of the West. Now, so what was Ockham doing? Well, what Ockham was doing was saying, hey, the papacy is so corrupt that you need to put the authority to interpret scripture under the emperor, under the political power. You know, there's no saving the papacy. What he's basically doing is setting it up so that somebody like Machiavelli later can come along and say, thank you, Ockham, for doing that. Because that allows us to control scripture so that we can have the authoritative means by which we can control the population who believes this stuff. Think of Henry VIII and his own, his own church. He's the supreme head of his own church. Well, that's what Ockham does. I think he sincerely wanted to reform the church, but what he ends up doing is giving scriptural authority to a ruler. Well, you might think, oh, well, if the ruler is good, maybe that's not so bad. Maybe it's better than this pope. What if the ruler is simply bent, like Henry VIII, on having political power, and he doesn't care how he bends scripture to get it? Right. Well, that's the problem with Ockham. He has good intentions in the worst sense of the term.
Right. It's interesting, too, because as you go through here, even with Luther, like you said, in a sense, here's somebody who, in theory, was a reformer, but it gets out of control. He loses control. We end up with the peasant war, and you end up with Calvin's version and then Zwingli's version, as everybody realizes they can interpret. And then the milkmaid says, well, if you can interpret scripture, then I can. and it really gets into where you can kind of suddenly say, since what I got out of these, they say, well, there is no real blueprint. And so though it says that we're, in a sense, scripture alone, but who can interpret what scripture actually says, and I can turn scripture, as you said, to whatever I'd like to do with it.
Yeah, and this again comes from the situation where Luther is looking at a corrupted papacy and a hierarchy, and his response is to put the power to interpret scripture underneath the political rulers, that is, in his instances, under the German princes that would protect him. Well, that's just what Machiavelli wanted. He wanted the prince to be in charge of religion so that he could use it as an instrument. And these German princes were happy to do that. But, Luther himself then ended up using scripture as a way to beat the peasants, because the peasants themselves were reading scripture and saying, wait a second, Jesus is coming to talk to the poor. He's on the side of the poor. He's not on the side of the princes. And we want these rights and these rights and these rights, and we're willing to rebel. But what Luther does is he then says, no, the authority over scripture and over the church resides in the prince, and he can basically do no wrong. Mm-hmm. And what that means is that you've politicized scripture so that it's a tool for princes to stamp down rebellions. And so once again, it's been corrupted. Luther thought he was doing a good thing, but what he's enabled is for that ancient pagan notion that religion is really not true. It's just something you use as a political instrument, and that fuels this notion that's at the foundation of modern scriptural scholarship. It's not really about the truth. It's all about politics.
Well, it's interesting, too, because you talk about how Erasmus, often credited with initiating the great push for the vernacular, was actually a Catholic. And what's interesting with you talk about the various translations and, why were some of them changed, etc., whether it had to do with, what text they were looking at, but also the idea that sometimes politically certain texts played better than others. Explain.
Well, the thing that happened, of course, with Martin Luther is he saw the corruption in the church. He said, okay, we're going to put authority in the Bible alone. Now, that meant that the Bible itself had to interpret itself. And so you have a lot of people then turning to the Bible, and there were serious scholars, and they're digging through things and they're finding in the manuscripts, oh, wait a second, there's this variant here, there's that variant there, there's this variant here, there's that variant. And so what they end up doing is uncovering all kinds of problems in textual authority in Scripture. Mm-hmm. And Erasmus, in a way, settled it prematurely by printing a Greek New Testament that was based on not the best manuscripts, because other ones would be recovered later. Mm-hmm. And that meant it was sort of frozen in time. So the scholars kept going, but the lay people had to have a Bible that they could look at and didn't change every week, mm-hmm. you know, because of somebody's new translation or some footnote or something like that. And so you have this great divide open up between the vernacular translations, and there were many of them, and the what the scholars were working on at any one time.
Right.
And so what you have is a kind of an authority problem arise, and each one of these groups is not only going to translate the Greek text or the Hebrew text in a way that fits their theology, but they're going to provide commentaries as well.
Right, and also the politics of their particular prince may have an impact on how they view that as well.
Yeah.
And just before we go, I just got to mention, you talk about things like the 30 Years' War. It's great to get the idea of how much of this was spun as being wars of religion when really they were wars of politics. But we're out of time. Thank you so much, Benjamin Wiker. People have to read this book along with Scott Hahn. The title, The Decline and Fall of Sacred Scripture, How the Bible Became a Secular Book. Emmaus Road Publishing, available naturally through the EWTN Religious Catalog. EWTNRC.com for all things Catholic. Definitely worth reading, especially with what's going on today. Thank you so much, Benjamin Wiker, for being here on Bookmark, and thank you all for joining us. We'll see you next time.